So today we will discuss number theory for cryptography. This is one of the most important topic and basic of number theory. We will find we are using different number theory techniques in RSA, like then we have already seen number theory concepts in DES, AES algorithms, and in EAC, elective curve cryptography. We will study next, where we will get many use of number theory for calculation. So in cryptography, you will find that mostly we use the positive numbers and they are integer. Okay, if somehow in some calculation, even if you find floating point numbers, we try to convert them into integers. Okay. So in cryptography, whatever algorithm you have came through, you have seen all of them was integers. Even in RSA, you will find things are calculations are done in integer only. So positive integers are very important for us. Now the positive integers can be, think in three ways. One is number one. That means exactly one divisor. That means there are many positive integers which are having exactly one divisor. Okay, then primes are having exactly two divisors, like that number itself and one, and composite integers which are having more than two divisors. Okay. So cardinality of prime numbers, that means if you think about how many prime numbers does exist in the world, the answer will be the same or same equal to what is called infinite. Okay, because we think in such theoretically that there is infinite number of integers. Okay, and prime numbers are basically subset of those natural numbers. Okay, so subset of an infinite set is also infinite. Okay, so number of integers, so you can simply say that there is infinite number of integers. And checking for primeness, how can we check the primeness of a number? So there is many methods, starting from our school life we are coming through. So this is one of the very basic method, that given a number n, how can we determine that if n is prime? The answer is that we need to see if the number is divisible by all primes less than root over n. Okay, so when you have studied C programming, you have done this program, right, this code you have written to check a prime number. So this method is insufficient, but it is good for a start. Okay, because when you will go for very big number test, so you are very big integer, you are going to test whether it is prime or not, this method gets failure. Okay, in some special cases. Okay, so why that if you test that all prime numbers less than root n only, then you can assure that n is a prime. So for proof, we can assume, or we can start working this way, that say n equal to a into b, and a is greater than 1 and less than n, and b is greater than 1 and less than n. Okay, so we have two integers, and we are assuming that, we are trying to prove that n equal to a into b. Obviously, if n is prime, this is not going to hold, right? So we can't have both, that is a greater than root n and b greater than root n. So if you take any number, you can check it as 9. So what are the root of 9? So 3 into 3, right? So root 9 are, so 9 is not integer even, okay? So you must understand. So if you check in prime reality of 9, you can see that root of n is 9, then it will be 3. And it is asking that It is saying that if n equal to, we are assuming n equal to a into b, and a must be greater than root n, sorry, it is not possible to a greater than root n and b greater than root n. So you can understand, like 12, you have two numbers, 3 into 4, right? So if you say root 12, it will be definitely around, you know, 3, greater than 3, right? And less than 4, somewhere around that it will come. So a will definitely be, you know, less than root n. So both together can't be greater than n. Greater than root n. Okay, so I think this is clear. And this would lead to a into b greater than n. So if you have somewhere that this a and b are, both of them are greater than root n, then definitely a times b will give you a number which is greater than n. So therefore, it must have a prime divisor less than or equal to root n. Okay, so if n is not prime, and if n is not if n is prime, then there should not be any prime divisor less than or equal to root n. So if you check that is 97 is prime, so how we can do it? First we have to find out what is the root 97. So root 97 is, if you just be very strict, it will give you some, it will give you some floating point number. So we can't calculate root 97 in integer. So what we will do, we'll take the floor value, or just below, or that number, whatever a square root number is available, we'll consider that. So here, smaller than 97 and nearest to 97, which is a square root number, which is square number, is 81. So we are assuming, or we are writing here root 97 equal to 9. So you can understand, right? We are not even going to calculate a direct root of this number, because all numbers may not have, definitely if they prime, definitely there will be no root, right? So what we will do, whatever number we will get, we will get the root of the nearest small and definitely smaller than that number, which is a root number, a square number. Okay, so here it is 81. So root 97 equal to 9, we are writing, we are taking the floor value. Okay, so less than 9, what are the prime numbers are available? 2, 3, 5 and 7, right? So our test will be whether 97 is divisible by 2 or 3 or 5 or 7. Okay, so if you check, definitely 97 can be divisible by 2, can be divided by 3, and can be divided by 5, and can be divided by 7. Okay, then 97 must be a prime number. Okay, so in the same way, if we see that whether 301 is a prime, the same thing, we have to find out what is the root of 301. So 301, and root of 301, if you take the floor value, it will give you 17. Okay, so we need to check what are the prime numbers less than 17. So there 2, 3, 5, 7, 11 and 13. And 17 itself you can consider. Okay, now the number 2, 3, 5 can't divide 301. Reason, 2 can divide only even number, so 301 is the odd number, so it can't be divided by 3. If it is divisible by 3, then the last digit, the sum of this number, I think, should be something divisible by 3 also. So it is sum of the digits of this 301 is 4, so it is not divisible by 3. And again, if some number is divisible by 5, it should be end with 0 or 5. So here it is ending with 1, so it is not divisible by 5, we can easily say. Okay, but if you check 7 can divide 301 or 301. So we can say 301 is not a prime number. And 5 estrusness theorem. So Seibel estrusness is one of the most efficient way to find all primes smaller than n. The numbers of time you have previously got questions like this, you know, list down all prime less than the given number n. So how we can do this, or how we can find all the prime numbers less than n? That can be, you know, work out by Seibel-Strauss-Ness theorem. So when n is smaller than 10 million or so, this theorem or this method works. Okay, and after that it shows some inconsistency for some special cases. Okay, so you can understand 10 million is a huge range, and it is also given that n is a small number. So here a small number means within range of 10 million. Okay, now how does it work? So say we want to find all prime numbers less than 50. So what do we do? We create a list of all numbers from 2 to 50. Okay, then mark all the numbers which are divisible by 2 or even number. Okay, so n is 50 here. So we have written 2 to 50, all the number we have listed down, and we just mark the even numbers, because we all know that even numbers can't be prime numbers. So you just mark them, or you just cut them out, okay, prune them out. Then next step, it is saying that move to our next unmarked number. So after doing that, so if you again start your iteration from the beginning and find the next unmarked number is here 3. Okay, and mark all numbers which are multiple of 3 and greater than are equal to the square of 8. So we have to mark all the numbers, or we have to ignore all the numbers which are divisible by 3 or root of 3 or greater than the root of 3. Okay, so go to do that. So let's do that. So 6 is marked, already marked. So 9 was not marked here, so 9 marked here. Okay, it is basically root of square of 3 and also divisible by 3. 21 is divisible by 3, and 27 divisible by 3, and 33 is divisible by 3, and 39 is divisible by 3. So all these numbers are marked, or you can say discarded from the consideration. So next step, you unmark number 5. So you have 5 here after 3, and you mark all numbers, all multiples of 5 and greater than or equal to the square of 8. Okay, so you have to find out first which is square of 5. Square of 5 is here 25. So whatever number after 25 or greater than 25 are divisible by 5, we'll mark them out. Okay, so we have 25 here. So after 25, 30 comes. So 30 already marked, 35 marked here. Okay, then 40 already marked, 45 marked here. Then no other are there, right? So these numbers, some more numbers are being out of the consideration. Okay, then this thing will continue for other numbers. Now continue this process for our final table. So continue this process for other numbers like 7, and then 9 is already marked, so you have not to do it for 9. You can do it for 11 also. Okay, so like that you do it. Okay, then continue this process, and our final table will look like this. So in the final table, you can find that some numbers are not being possible to mark, and some numbers are being marked with red. Okay, so those unmarked numbers are basically prime numbers below the given n. That means our n was 50, so our prime numbers below 50 are these all these unmarked numbers. Okay, so this is the method is followed, given by Eratosthenes. Okay, then Euler phi function, or sometimes we call it as totient function also. So it plays a very important role in cryptography. We will find when we will study RSA, we are using this Totian function. Okay, the Totian function phi n of a positive integer n greater than 1, so n is greater than 1, is defined to be the number of positive integers less than n that are co-prime to n. So in previous method we have seen how to find out prime numbers less than n, and here one thing is, one additional condition is added to it, that the prime numbers must be less than n, and also it should be co-prime to n. Okay, like if you see, for example, if you take 1, the Protean function of 1 will give you 1, because it is, you know, number of primes less than or equal to 1, which are also co-prime to 1. Okay, so number of prime which are co-prime to 1 is 1, so phi n is 1. Okay, for 2 it is again phi n is 1. If for 3, if you check, you know, less than 3, there is 2 prime numbers, 1 and 2, and both are co-prime to 3, so phi n is here 2. For 4, it is having 2 prime numbers less than 4, 1 and 3, and you can see, you know, both of them are co-prime to 4, so phi n is 2. It's okay, like, you know, for 5, if you check, so co-prime to 5 are 1, 2, 3 and 4, so you can't divide 5 by any of these numbers, so phi n will be 4. Okay, in the same way, if you see for 6, you have only 2 numbers, 1 and 5, which can't divide 6, so they are co-prime to 6. Okay, so how many numbers are there? 2 numbers. So copra phi of 6, or Totian function 6 is 2. So I think it is clear what does it mean. Co-prime means any number less than the given number which can't divide that given number n. Okay, that number is co-prime. So that co-prime itself can be, you know, even or odd number, or may not be prime number. So you must be, you know, remember this. Then some other thing related to this Totian function, if you do phi of 1, then Totian function of 1, that means less than 1, how many number are there, or basically positive numbers are there, which can which is co-prime to 1? So definitely then 0 numbers. Okay, then say you have a prime number p. Okay, if prime number p, the Totian function of the prime is equal to p minus 1. That means if you have say 9 is a prime number, so p is 9. So how many, you know, how many co-primes does 9 have? So 9 have 9 minus 1 equal to 8 co-primes. Okay, then if you have a number in phi which can be represented by m into n, okay, then you can just break down the operation or calculation like phi m into phi n if m and n are already prime. So this thing can be, this composition rule can be applicable only if m and n is prime. Okay, so like you will find in RSA, we will do that n equal to, we take p into q, and p and q are prime. So there, you know, this formula or this property of Totian function can be used. Okay, then if you have a prime number and with a exponential e, that can be written like this: p to the power e minus p to the power e minus 1. So that many, you know, co-prime, p to the power e will have if p is definitely prime. Okay, so these are the 4 basic properties, and third property is very, very, very important for RSA algorithm. Okay, then this is with an example. You can see that if p is prime, and say here are the prime numbers, if you put any number here, like I have I have already told you. Now if you take p equal to 11, then how many co-prime of 11 are there? Definitely it will be, you know, 11 minus 1, that 10 co-prime will be there. Okay, then Euler's phi function, some more example, like I had to told you this, you know, third property is very important. Say you have 15, and 15 can be written as 3 into 5, and both 3 and 5 are prime numbers. So we can say phi of 15 or totient function 15 equal to phi 3 into phi 5. Phi 3 is how many co-prime of 3 are there? So it is a prime number, so you can simply write it 3 minus 1, number of primes are there, that 3 minus 1 is 2, and 5 is also prime, so you can say 5 minus 1 equal to 4 numbers of co-prime are there. Okay, so result will be 2 into 4 equal to 8. Okay, but if you look at example 9, so 9 can be represented by 3 into 3, both of them are co-prime, sorry, both of them are prime, because 3 is a prime number. Now, phi 9 equal to what? 6, right? Phi 9 equal to 6, because you know, below 9 there is 3, there is 3 which can, you know, divide 9. So, and another number is there, so no. So 9 is having total four prime. If you look at this table, yeah, so 3 and 6 is not there, okay, because 6 and 9 are having some common factor. So 6 is not a, 6 is not a co-prime to 9. So 1, 2, 4, 5, 7 and 8, these are the 6 numbers which are co-prime to 9, clear? So phi 9 is already 6. Now, according to this third property, if you put here, you know, phi 3 into phi 3, so phi 3, you know, it is 2. So it is 2 into 2 equal to 4. So it is giving, you know, wrong result. Okay. So in this type of cases, this you know, third property will not be applicable. Now, general formula to compute phi n. So how we can calculate phi n if it is a, you know, very big number? So still now we was looking at small numbers in the table here. Up to 15, we can test all the co-prime manually, and we can say, okay, these many co-primes are there. But if you know, if I give you a big number, then what will be the way to find out all co-primes? So the way is n into 1 minus 1 by p1 into, you know, up, this thing will go up to 1 minus 1 by pn. Now, where this n is equal to, sorry, this n is equal to multiplication of all p1 to the power e1, p2 to the power e2, and so on up to pn to the power en. Okay, so in the, okay, so this is the generalized formula for finding out numbers of co-prime or totient function for any given number. Now, the difficulty of finding and if I have written phi, it should be phi n, depends on the difficulty of finding the factorization of n. Okay, so if you can factorize n easily, you can do the calculation easily. So now, instead of doing another previous, you know, this property, you know, this property, if we use this generalized method, and if we try to find out you know, all the number of co-prime of a given number, then what will happen? See, so we consider 9. 9 equal to 3 square, right? So 3 is the p here, and e1 is 2 here. Okay, so phi 9 equal to 1, sorry, phi 9 equal to 9 into 1 minus 1 by p1, so p1 is here 3, so 1 by 3. So if you just simplify this, you will get 6 as a result, so it is correct result. For 2, sorry, for 4, 4 we can represent as 2 to the power 2. So only one term we are getting here, where that, you know, this 2 is p1, and this 2 is the exponent e1. Okay, so phi 4 equal to 4 into 1 minus 1 by 2, you will get the result equal to 2. This is also correct result. Now if you consider 15, 15 can be represented as 3 into 5, right? 3 into 5. So we have basically two p's here, right? So p equal to what? P equal to p1 to the power u1 and so on up to pn to the power en. So here you can see p1, p2 we have, and with powers are basically 1 here, okay? e1 equal to 1, e2 equal to 1 here. So 15 equal to 15 into 1 minus 1 by p1 into 1 minus 1 by p2. If you simplify this, you will get 8, and which is again correct result. So this is the generalized formula for computation of phi n. So when you will implement SRS algorithm, you will have to find out numbers of co-prime or phi, this phi function, okay? And you can just use this and you can find out what is the phi n, okay? Then, what is the value of phi 13? Randomly, if somebody asks you, because 13 is a prime, you can straightforward answer it. This is 13 minus 1 equal to 12, okay? But if somebody asks you, what is the value of phi 10? Then you have to think, right? Because 10 is not a prime number. So what we can do, we can use again the third property. And even if you use the third property, you may not be very much sure, because third property does not, this property does not answer correct all the time. But in this, for 10, it will definitely give you correct answer. Okay, so it is, 10 is, can be divided into 2 into 5. Okay, both of them are primes. So phi 2 and in multiplication with phi 5. So phi 2 we know 1 and phi 5 we know 4 equal to 4. Okay, because 2 and 5 are prime. Okay, now if somebody asks you, what is the value of phi 240? Now it is something you need to think about. Okay, now we can write 240 equal to 20 into 31. It should be actually, I think it should be 2 to the power 4, 3 to the power 1 if we do. And there is something miss, some typo I have made here, okay? So I'm not discussing this problem. There is typo. Okay. Now, can you say what is phi 49? So again, 49 can be done into, can have two, can be divisible by, 7, and 7 into 7, it is a square of a prime number. So it is going to give you 36 as a result. Is it correct result? Because if you have seen the same situation for 9, so, you have to be cautious about this kind of situation whenever you will get. So definitely answer will be no. The third rule applies when m and n are relatively prime. Understand? They are not same. Here 49 equal to 7 square. Okay, this is not 72, this is 7 square. We need to use the fourth rule. Fourth rule gives you 49 equal to 7 square minus 7 to the power 1. Okay, if you do that, then you will get answer 42. And that will be the correct answer. Okay. Now, when the number of elements in Z14, that means the integer space of 14, the answer is 514 equal to 14, 2 factor, 7 and 2, both are prime. So you can have 6 as answer. The members are, all these 1, 3, 5, 4, 9, 11, and 3. So I think enough. I have given examples and discussed on this. Okay. Now come to Fermat's theorem. So Fermat's theorem is basically a special case of Euler's theorem. So Euler's theorem generalizes the Fermat's theorem to the case where the modulus is not prime. So in okay, so Fermat's theorem says the modulus is prime only. So if n is a positive integer and a and n are co-prime, understand? If n is a positive integer, and a and n are coprime. Okay, then a to the power phi n congruent 1 mod n. Okay, so in a modern arithmetic, in modern arithmetic, a to the power phi n will give you 1 basically. Okay, where phi n is the Euler's Totian function. Okay, so Euler's theorem generalizes the Fermat theorem, I have already told you. Then the first version of the theorem looks like this. A to the power, say if n is definitely prime, then the definitely we are going to get phi n equal to n minus 1. So for prime number, okay, the Fermat theorem will look like this. A to the power n minus 1 congruent to 1 mod n. And second version gives you a to the power n, say a to the power n minus 1 means what? A to the power n divided by a congruent 1. So this inverse a, what is a divided by a, this a can be multiply with 1 and come here. So in modular arithmetic we can write that a to the power n congruence to a mod n. If n is a positive integer and a n are coprime, and this a to the power phi n is equal to 1 mod n, where phi n is equal to Euler Totian function, then you do this. Say 165 are being given, we can have 165 is having two factor of 15 and 11. 15 into 11 equal to 165. So phi, 165 we can write equal to phi 15 into phi 11. So which is equal to I think it will give you 80. Okay, so phi 15 is 8 and phi 11 is 10, so it is 80. Okay, so we can write that 8 to the power, just a minute here, again some typo I have made. So we can write that 80 congruents 1 in mod 165 arithmetic. Okay, so like if you take this number 1716, it have 3 factors, 11, 12 and 13. Okay, so using the third principle, we can third properties, we can write 1716 equal to 511, 512 and 513. And 11 and 13 are here prime, they are prime numbers. So 11 will give you 10, 13 will give you 12, so 120, and 12 will give you, I think, 4. Okay, yeah, 512 is 4. So you will get 480. Okay, so you can write that 74 to the power 8, it will be actually congruent 1 mod, in modular arithmetic of 1716. Okay, so these things you will find, you have to use in RSA-like algorithms where you have to find out, prime numbers and their, Totian function and roots, all these things. Okay. Even in some other algorithms where you will need to factorize number, then all these things will be applicable. Now, if n is a positive number, a n are coprime, then a to the power phi n plus 1 mod, congruence a mod n. So this is we have already seen. Okay, basically it is multiplying a both the side and to the previous formula, and it is getting this formula. I think you understand this. Previously it was a to the power phi n congruence 1 mod n. Okay, now how this is coming, a to the power phi n plus 1 can be written as a to the power phi n into a, right? So this is, and on the other side, if you multiply a with 1, you will get only a. Okay, so And previously we have this a to the power phi n congruence 1 in mod n and a congruence a in mod n. So we know all these things are true. So if we combine this third line and fourth line, we'll get a to the power phi n plus 1 equal to a mod n. Okay. So another corollary is here. If n is a positive integer and a and n are co-prime, then b congruence 1 mod phi n. Then a to the power a congruence, sorry, a to the power b congruence a mod n. Okay, now if b congruent 1 mod phi n, then it can be written as b equal to k multiplication phi n plus 1. That is a very simple, you know, the division rule. What, you know, for some k is the, you know, basically a result of the division. Okay, for some k, then we can write a to the power b. So you just put these values out at the power of a. So you can write a to the power b, a to the power k into phi n plus 1 equal to this is again equal to a to the power phi n to the power k into a, since a to the power phi n congruence 1 mod n. All right. So from this again we can rewrite this term. Okay, this term a to the power phi n k a can be, you know, forgotten because this a basically a to the power 1, you can think about this way. Just a minute, from where it is coming, if you replace this by this term, then this equivalence a mod n it was. So here it is, here basically you are dividing by n here, you know, by a in the both the side, so a will be forgotten from this side, right? And this a will be forgotten from here. Okay, so only this term will remain. Okay, and equal to the, again this side, one a will be there, that will be forgotten, and only one will be remain. So equal to 1 mod n. Then you can also say that this line is basically, I was telling you previously, before. So a to the power phi n to the power k into a congruence equal congruence a mod n. This is why RSA works. This is what we use in RSA algorithm, and later we will discuss RSA algorithm. And you can see here Rotian function is used here, modular arithmetic is, and basically this is the outcome of the Fermat theorem and Euler's theorem. Okay. So if I ask you to find the result of 6 to the power 24 mod 35. So usually what we will do, we will take a calculator, we will calculate 6 to the power 24, which will be a big calculation, and we will get a big number, and then we will divide that by 34 and we will try to get out what is the remainder, right? But using Euler theorem, we can do it in short. How we can do it? What is the given problem? We have 16 to the power 24 mod 35. So we can simply convert this problem to 6 to the power, instead of 24, you write 35 mod 35. Okay, because I think 24 is 535. Okay. So if you find out the number of co-prime of 35, you will get 24. So 6 to the power 24 can be written as 6 to the power 35 mod 35. And as per this previous rule, what you have seen in the previous slide, we can say this equal to 1. Okay. Again, if you get another problem like this, 20 to the power 62 mod 77. So again, we have to first find out how this 62 can be represented in the way of pi 77. If you can do this, then you can find out the result easily. Okay. So if we take k equal to 1 on the second version, in the second version with k, what we had discussed in the previous year, you know, here, if you apply this with k equal to 1, then we have 22 to the power 62, sorry, 20 to the power 62 mod 77, which can be written like this: 20 mod 77, 20 to the power 5, 20 to the power 5, 77 plus 1 mod 77 mod 77. Okay. So why do we need to do that? Because if you straightforward get try to get you know, 577, it is not going to be 62. Okay, but if you modify, simplify this, you will get that it is going to get total 20 to the power 62 if you simplify this, okay, in mod 77 operation. Okay. So by doing this, we can apply the formula in the previous slide I have shown. So this simplified to 20 mod 77, which is 20 itself, okay, and 20 to the power 7 pi 77 plus 1 mod 77 will give you 20 again, it's 20 itself, and mod 77 come from here to here. Okay, now 20 into 20 mod 77 give you 15. Okay, so 15 is the result of this calculation. Okay, then comes multiplicative inverse. Euler theorem can be used to find out multiplicative inverse of a modular composite. So I have already told you what is multiplicative inverse. So A inverse mod n can be written as A to the power phi n, okay, as mod n is if mod, this n, okay, A to the power phi n minus 1 mod n. Okay, so here are some examples of finding out multiplicative inverse using Euclidean algorithm. In previous session we have discussed a lot on this, I think, about how to find out multiplicative inverse using simple Euclidean method, and this is what is called extended Euclidean method is used here. It uses factorization. Okay, so these are the example. I'm not going to explain this example. Okay, so I'm not